Hello and welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallis and today we're firmly sticking with the whole idea of DevOps. We're looking at Vagrant, but provisioning in Vagrant. With provisioners, we can go through and use either scripts or configuration management systems to help our deployment. Now, if you're used to using Ansible, and I'm a big fan of Ansible, so why not take a look at Ansible as well? We're able to use our playbooks, and we can be using them the same playbooks that we use in our production environment. We can use those playbooks within our development environment as well, keeping that consistency, and that's so important, isn't it? But maybe you don't want the Ansible software installed on your Vagrant host. Well, that doesn't matter either. We have an Ansible local provisioner, and with that, we're installing then Ansible onto our guest machines to have the local Ansible provision the playbook. Come on, let's go through and look at this really important feature. Hello, and welcome to this video from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett, and I've been here on YouTube since 2009, with my channel's emphasis on you learning Linux. Linux will always be front and center. Detailed blogs of these videos can be found at the Urban Penguin, where we're currently covering Linux, Ansible, SaltStack, and Puppet. So here we are on my Ubuntu Vagrant host. I'm in the Vagrant directory where I keep all of my Vagrant environments or projects. I'm going to create myself a new project directory for a web server, and we're going to be able to see how we can quickly and easily deploy a standard box, but with our Apache web server installed and ready to go. So we're going to be taking a look at a little bit of provisioning here, a little bit of port forwarding, and we're also going to be setting our host name. So we can go through and set up our directory for our environment. We can then move into that environment, so escape and dot brings up our last argument. I know it's only three characters, but getting used to some of these bash shortcuts are really worthwhile. So escape and dot brings up your last argument. As we then start going through, of course, is a new and empty directory. We don't have anything here. We're going to copy across an existing Vagrant file we have. It's pretty much standard, so it's going to have an awful lot of comments in it. When I go through and list this Vagrant file out, you can see what I mean. So the only really effective setting we've got is the box name. It's CentOS 7. But if we go through using our stream editor, we can quickly clear out those comments. So minus uppercase E allows for an enhanced regular expression. Minus lowercase I is an in-place edit. And we're looking then for the regular expression with lines that begin with any white space and any amount of white space. The slash s is our white space, and then the asterisk means any amount of white space, so zero or more. Then followed by our group. This is why we're using the uppercase E, and we're grouping. We're saying it can begin with a white space followed by the end of line marker or our comment. We then go through and delete those lines. So now when we look at our Vagrant file, it's very clean and easy to read. We can go through and copy the existing line down a couple of times. We can set up our host name, so config, which is our namespace that we're working in. And we can set this then to be hostname equals web or anything. It doesn't matter. When we go through and look at our next line, we can go through and change this. It can be our provisioner. So we can go through and use config.vm.provision. We don't need the equal here, so we're going to delete the equal sign because we're going to set it to be over multiple lines. We might want to set multiple properties to that. So we're using Ansible underscore local. Now, if we just use Ansible, Ansible would then be run on our host system. Ansible underscore local means that we don't need Ansible installed. It will be installed into our guests. So that's often a very preferable way of doing it. We're going into a looping structure and we're calling then the namespace to loop around just A for Ansible. We can end then our loop. I like the color coding turned on, so I'm just setting the file type equals Ruby. It just makes it a little easier to read. And then just indenting two spaces inside of our config. we can then go through with our namespace a.playbook equals, and then the name of the playbook that we want to execute. And this should be a string, so I need to quote it. So I'm calling it playbook.yaml, but let's just put quotes around it just so the Ruby knows that it's a string we're talking about. But I could then have multiple properties. I'm leaving it like this. I don't need to add any other properties at the moment. Mainly, I can set it in my playbook. But it gives you the idea of setting up these namespaces. I'm also going to add in another config option. To be able to access our web server, we can enable our networking and port forwarding. We do have port forwarding for SSH by default, but we want to then set up our VM.network, and we can then have this being our forwarded underscore port. Once we get this spelled correctly, forwarded underscore port. It has a couple of options. So we're going through and say our guest. So we want to connect to port 80 on our web server. So this is going to be my guest virtual machine. But we can then point our browser through to our local host and port 8080, anything that's available on your local host. So that should be good to go as far as this is concerned. But of course, don't forget, we've got to create our playbook. Now, the playbook then is just a list of instructions for Ansible to carry out. But say we don't need Ansible installed on our host machine. Ansible underscore local is going to then make sure that Ansible is installed on the guest machine. We can set our three dashes for a YAML file header. Then we can name our play. A playbook contains multiple plays. And we're just going to go through, again, I'm just using two spaces to indent here. And we're then going to go through and set up our hosts to be all. We don't need to worry about the inventory. That's managed by Vagrant itself. We can say that we want to elevate our privileges, or everything we need to do in this has to be run with sudo. We don't need to collect any additional facts. And then we have a list of tasks. Again, if you're used to Ansible, this is really easy for you. If you want to use a different provisioner, then of course you can use different provisioners. So we can use Puppet, we can use Salt, we can go through and use, as we're using here, Ansible. As we then go through in our task, again, we indent these. And we can say that we're installing Apache using the package module. And then the properties of the package module, again, indenting inside of package. So it's going to be the HTTP daemon, and we want to then go through and make sure the state of the package is installed. So we can go through and put state, colon, and present. Now, that installs Apache but won't start it. So we can then go through and have a task to start our Apache web server. We can go through and use the service module. And the nice thing about this, once we've created our playbook, we know it's going to be reliable. And so long as we reference our playbook, we know then our virtual machines are going to be set up correctly. So we can go through with our service module, making sure, again, the name is HTTP, the state is started, and we can enable the service so it automatically starts. So we want enabled being true. So with our playbook created, we should be good to go with this. So let's go through and save it. We can always go through and take a look at what we've done. So we can take a look at our Vagrant file. So still relatively straightforward. And then our playbook. Now with all of this then done, we can go through and use our Vagrant up. We can see then that we're creating our virtual machine. So we're cloning the CentOS 7 box. We're setting up our port forwarding, so we can see that we had port 22 forwarded anyway, but we've now got port 80 going to 8080. We can see as we start running through, we're setting up the host name. We've got syncing a folder set up by default as well, so we can see that that's happening. But at the moment, we can see then for the default machine, we're installing Ansible. We only need to worry about installing this once. Provisioning only happens when we create the VirtualBox. We can force it to run again later by using something like --- provision when we use up. But if the box is already there, it doesn't need to go through the provisioning stage again. So don't think that this is going to take a long time to boot each time. We can see now that we've opened up our playbook and we're seeing the results of Ansible executing. And of course, the first thing that we're doing is installing the Apache web server. So we can allow this to chug through. And then, of course, once we have it installed, Apache, we can move on to that second task. And that second task is going to ensure that the service is running. So we can see now we've started and enabled our Apache server. If we go through and check Vagrant port, we're going to be able to see the ports that we have on our local host and where they're pointing to. So we know we can fire up our browser now and go to port 8080 on our local host. So if we go HTTP and then localhost colon 8080, we should be then pointing to our install of Apache, and we can see then that we're getting the CentOS page coming back. We've been able to get our machine installed and Apache up and running so we can access it from our local host.
All that is left to say is thank you for watching. If you've enjoyed this, then you are probably sadder than I first thought. For more of this drivel, please subscribe, like and comment to @theurbanpenguin.